And obviously the Zerg, any good Zerg always has their stuff ready at the ramp. Now he's going to hug the minerals over here. Oh, he might actually poke back in, but he's going to eventually shade to the bottom part of the map, I believe. He should not cancel. Okay, there we go. He cancels there. The Ling's coming surrounding. Yeah. I'm like,
it's like, well, hush.
I'm like, okay, I mean, Protoss, eventually going to have to stop doing this. There's been too much fancy stuff with shading where I'm like, well, you might want to use that to keep your unit alive as well.
Got to keep those alive for the time being. Now, the Banelings plus Lings here mean that as long as he stays defensively, the Adepts shouldn't be able to get any damage done. And he's making plenty of spores, so I don't see a real way in for Hush right now. And, I mean, this is such a late third base for the matchup. Like, Protoss really needed third base to completely do anything. And I don't think Hush is trying to kill him. He's just trying to really heavily pressure.
All right, Phoenix has come up now. And not bad, just takes out a few Banelings.
Ah. All right. Well, taking out those Banelings does make it easier to attack in. Glaive's on the way, third base as well.
Do you think he's actually going to attack in fully? I think he's just peeking. Well, he definitely is going to cancel that.
Yeah, no, I don't think he can.
Oh, that was like, cool. If you comes out and he gets the Banelings when they come in. That's really cool.
That's so smart.
Yeah, I really like
Ooh,
that.
Ooh, chills.
Yeah.
Of the nerd type.
Uh-oh, he's going to spot the pylon, though. With Ling Baneling style, it should be easy to get something over there to take out that pylon.
Yeah, I would say most likely. But he can't really send too many units over there because there's a possibility Hush reacts very quickly to that and just kind of gets a bunch
now,
of
damage. Is he going to go behind the minerals and just let it come in?
Look, he's
yeah,
just going to pick
it.
Up Banes. Oh, my God.
Oh, my God. That's
this is so
sick.
Smart. So good.
Oh, my God. He actually can't get back there. Look at that. Zerk cannot get back there. That is so, so sick.
Yeah.
Look at him.
He
did it again.
Picks up every Banes.
Get the other one. He doesn't
these
have
are
to
good
do it.
Moves, man.
He can do whatever he wants from right out. Oh, now he's in the main.
These
but he
moves
needs
are
to move
so
these.
Good. Yeah, he just stands there and it's like, oh, he won't
he's
see
like,
me here.
All right, here we go. Get the Baneling.
Oh, it does hit.
I forgive you. You're still handsome.
Still, if he can pick up some Hydras here, even just whittling down the Hydralisk count could be very helpful.
Look at this down and dirty Adept style. This is all tactics here.
Yeah.
Now, unfortunately, he's starting to get a little bit short on the Adept count, but I don't know how much more he's warped in behind this.
If he keeps his Phoenixes all alive, I think he's still totally fine. He doesn't get many drones, but he trades for a hell of a lot of units there. The thing is, though, he's built his Phoenix count, whereas what has Solar built here?
Yeah, but also notice that the probe count's way lower than it should be. It's 46 to 63. That's actually quite a little bit weird,
right.
Considering that it was actually Zerg at least losing a few drones there. You would have actually expected he would have done a little bit more damage.
He didn't get any real damage with the Adepts.
This is actually something I've had a problem with back when I was playing in tournaments. Was like I refused to believe that I had to keep making more probes later on in the game. I'd like get to this point where the action would pick up and I'd stop. And I'd have to like look at my replays and be like, oh, my God. All right, I don't have enough workers here. I'm doing everything fine, but I need to keep doing that. But I'm wondering, you know, we were talking about, because the thing is he's been making probes this whole time. It's still at 46.
Yeah.
Like, I think that he just stopped doing it. And I know I wouldn't normally say this about a player, even in Code A, but I think he might have gotten nervous and just stopped doing it.
He has maybe the worst nerves out of any top player. You can't even consider him a top player. That's how bad his nerves are.
That's what keeps him from being a top player, is the nerves. Because he's still not making workers.
That would make some sense, but maybe this is, like, such – like, in defense, basically – his patches are not. Oh God! Only
no,
nine probes. There's no defense.
There's no excuse.
If he had the third fully saturated, I could have made something up. But nothing.
Yeah.
I got nothing.
I mean, there's never a moment really where you have three bases, and you're not. Especially for a game that's gone this long, almost 10 minutes. You're supposed to have that up, which means I think Zerg just kind of holds this.
With those Banelings about to morph in, this could get really dirty really fast. Okay, he picks up all the morphing Banelings here and goes on top of the Hydras as well. There are so many Phoenixes gaining a ton of value.
Nicely done. He can pick up the scraps here. And I think he's just going to shade into the natural again. Wow, look at this. So much damage being done here. Shades forward. Drones are pulled. Picks up the queen. Gets the other queens and Hydras over here. That means the Adepts win the ground
fight.
Did Hush do it? By the way, Hush now almost in the same number of workers as his opponent. Solar just blindsided. Okay,
I'm not sure about, like, he may have not wanted to make him just because he needed his money right then and right there. The one thing I can say other than that, because this is like something you don't see people do exactly, like he's luring things out of position to pick them up with Phoenixes. Yeah. It was really cool. But the main thing, especially with that first huge set of adepts that he was warping in the main with and everything, remember that set?
Yeah.
Like, what he was gaining there, he didn't necessarily need to kill drones. He could trade with units because he was building a Phoenix count, and when Phoenixes get too high in number, they can start to snowball if you don't have enough units. And, like, he built this amazing set of units, 11 Phoenixes at that point after that attack, that Solar didn't have anything to actually fight against. All he can do is continue to make Hydras.
Yeah, it was a problem.
That plays into the Adept Phoenix player.
That was actually some of the best tactical Phoenix usage I've ever seen.
That was fantastic.
I mean, you think about it, he like baited out the Banelings enough times. Then he just like waited until his Adepts were in the exact right spot. Boom.
Yeah.
And a lot of times when you have that many Phoenixes, sometimes the game can get turned on its head in like a minute and 30 seconds even. All right, guys, hushing the lead. Can he keep it going? We're moving into game number four in our second best of five in tonight's GSL Code 8.
In the bottom left, our Zerg player, he needs to win the next two games.
Samsung Galaxy, Sola.
Very important match for this man. Wants to make it to BlizzCon, does not have those points yet.
His story might end here in the next hour or so. In the bottom right, in the red, he needs to win just one more game to get that spot.
If Hush wins a best of five on TV, that is the first step to curing his anxieties, man.
Yeah. Then you got to look back and be like, wait a minute, I'm a good player. I just beat Solar in a best of five.
Solar's been
preparing
one of the best
for a long time for this, by the way.
Yeah, top four in SSL. Like, this guy has won tournaments overseas. Solar's a really, really great player. So if Hush beats him here on TV, I hope no matter what, if Hush just dies 0-2 terribly here, I still hope he's gained a lot of fans today in the foreign scene, because this guy... He's what a beautiful Protoss player he is. You saw tactics that you really haven't seen tonight.
Yeah.
And like a new build order that we haven't really seen. And I mean, this is awesome, man. He's like, he is a strategic leader of Protoss. It's just someone that no one ever thinks of because he can't win a game. But now he's won two, and he only needs three.
He's one win away, man. But Solar is pretty clutch. We wouldn't be talking about him so much if he wasn't. So I mean, Solar's definitely capable. We had a counterclockwise scout here from Hush. So he finds Zerg in the last possible spot. So no pylon delay this time around.
No. A little bit of a heartbreaker there for Hush.
The gods of RNG have frowned on him today.
That's why he's going to lose Stasis. He needed that Cybernex core block.
Does Hush go for that Stargate style again?
I think.
With Adepts?
I think he will. This map is...
This map's fine for it, I think.
Yeah. Like, this map, King Sejong Station seemed all right for it.
Well, King Sejong Station, I think, is actually great for it, especially when we saw how he won. I'm like, oof, forget about normal games on that map.
Yeah, you know what? Lairlak Crest is not really a great map for it, for sure. So, like, I think this is the strat he wants to use the most. I think and here's the thing, because we haven't really seen it done this way. We've seen things like Phoenix Adept, but this is a new take on it, a new way that he's doing it with such a late third and, like, all this nonstop pressure and nonstop Phoenixes. So, yeah, I don't know. It's a really cool style, but he is rotating out of it now. He's going into a Robo. That's a very fast one, too.
Okay. Let's see where the game goes from here. Now we have Solar going for Link Speed, 10 Lings, and a Baneling Nest.
Oh, well, that's a lot.
That's kind of funny. There's a probe hidden in the upper right. I don't know what he'd hide up there for now. But whatever he hit up there, I think most certainly would never be scouted for the entire game. 18 Lings now, 20 Lings now.
That is so many Lings. If he moves out at all, he's dead. Wow. Well, I guess it's probably Disruptor Drops? Right?
I don't know. I guess.
Well, here's a funny thing. Like, against this many Lings, if he made one Colossus at that range, like...
I think he just cracks the Protoss here, man.
Well, okay, what units does he have?
He has a Zealot
and a Stalker, and he has a Mothership Core, right? Or does he not?
Well, I think there's a Mothership Core somewhere
here.
I think
he's just dead.
Yeah, I think he just watched this. Oh, da-da-da-da-da-da. What? Da-da. Okay, there we go.
Okay, well, he was too slow to actually build anything there, and that is it.
GG.
Okay.
That wasn't just a bop, that was a beep and bop. Solar just completely ran over his opponent. I mean, he made that look so easy.
Well, that definitely was so easy.
That was so easy.
That was a free victory right there.
That is the kind of build that makes a Protoss a little bit salty.
Yeah, yeah. He had a build he chose. Once his scout was denied, he just... This was a great follow-up.
It was like, supplies!
Yeah. Supplies, as in rent supplies.
As in you don't have any supply because I got your pylon.
Yep.
And now there's banelings in your base. And it turns out the baneling against the probe, an imbalanced matchup.
I know, right? It's so unfair. One probe beats one baneling.
Yeah.
Unless that baneling is plus two.
Well, it's all going to come down to this last game. Only one player can move on to the GSL CODES. Will it be Solar the veteran, or will it be Hush the rookie? If Solar moves on, he once again solidifies what most people think of him, a solid, good player.
Yeah.
Who's always supposed to be in CODES. If Hush wins here, we have to reevaluate him. He is no longer that anxious player people claim is great to practice with, but cannot bring the results necessary to be a tournament player. We'll have to identify him as a CODES player who takes out somebody who's top four worthy, Solar.
Yeah, yeah, that would be a huge victory for a Hush to make it into CODES.
Let's do it, Chase Hush. Let's go. In the upper right, in the blue, our Zerg player.
Samsung Galaxy Solar.
Drinking water.
Staying hydrated.
One of our glasses players.
One of our gum chewers. In the bottom left.
CJ Anderson, Hoshi.
Remember when two players had glasses? You said
the battle of the glasses. No, it's the battle of the bad eyesight.
Yeah, that's so funny.
Thanks for coming down, guys. Welcome to the studio. Oh, I can see myself in the background.
Oh, my God, yeah, that's you.
That was me.
Wow, sick photobomb.
I saw somebody in the background. I'm like, that person should take a seat. And then I'm like, oh, that's me.
Yeah. That guy needs a shave. Oh, my God.
That guy looks like a savage.
Tasis, you're just so vain.
Okay, so.
Why do you have to be in every shot, Tasis?
Look at this, man. He actually got the block here.
Yeah.
Okay. This is already going well for Hush. And there it is. Oh, get away! And is the shield's going to come back in time?
It is.
Okay, there we go. Gets the block off. Only two bases right now for Solar. He's having to play by Hush's rules.
Once again, Hush being very good about that so far in the series. But, I mean, we know how this goes. He'll make a Cybernex core there. Tasis will pretend like he sees that every single game. He won't give Hush any credit for his great strats he's brought out tonight.
These amazing builds where he techs. I think Hush is going to be using a lot of the gas
guys,
in this game.
Don't you think it's really weird that Tasis thinks Protoss need 446 probes when obviously they only need 46 probes in three bases? It's like, well, I mean.
I am really curious about that 46 probe number, by the way.
Yeah.
Because, like,
the rest
of what Hush did was fine, but I thought, ooh. Because, you know, he was doing, in that initial attack in Game 3, he did kill a lot of Zerg units, but Zerg was, like, I believe it over 60 drones.
Yeah.
Or, like,
yeah.
A very high number it's like, well,
he was, like, full saturation.
It actually doesn't matter at what you're killing at this point in time, because unless you're killing workers, Zerg just makes more than you.
Yeah.
So, he leaves the Cybernetics core here because it's worth losing the minerals in those buildings to stop Zerg from having another base.
Mm-hmm.
And obviously, he already had a second one back at home. He's going to get the Phoenixes. He's hitting a probe again pretty well. And he's going to probably use that to check when the fourth base is taken. But right now, not a huge tempo lead, but a little bit of one going to Hush.
Yeah, I mean, this is how he wants it to go so far. So you have to definitely consider that when trying to evaluate the positions. One thing I want to point out that Solar is a little bit weird and different from almost every other Zerg in the world right now is that he's not getting Overlord speed early. And we see almost every Zerg do that right now.
I am actually curious about that.
because he seems now maybe he doesn't do it get overlord speed because he has some kind of cheese coming up. That's also possible. I don't know.
Maybe.
But yeah, that is strange. I actually hadn't even occurred to me until you pointed out. Yeah, everybody else is doing that except for him. Yeah. Now, luckily for him, he gets the overlord in there despite it being slow and sees that there's going to be air tech coming here.
Yeah.
He sees it's going to be an oracle. Hush was trying to be hyper vigilant and stop that possible scout from coming in. I think if he really wanted to stop it, though, he should have put the Stargate in a different spot.
Yeah, he was. I think it's just a matter of pylon count.
Yeah, I think you're right.
He made one early on in the other location, so it's like. And the thing is, I think what he's trying to do here is get a really fast third. Like, he should be taking the third right now.
Yeah.
So he had to build his pylons down the ramp to secure it. And this is kind of the one of the cool things about blocking all the way with Cybernetics Core. His third is not that much slower than Solar's. Like, Solar's finishes? Ooh, that's a great
pick-off.
That's
actually pretty big. Killed the drone. They could have taken the fourth. That is a really good routing path there to send that on.
That was a really, really good catch. Because as soon as you see that he's taking a
third
base.
He's going to swoop around. Let's see if he gets the second kill.
Oh, my
he's
God. That would be so
is
big.
He gonna, is he going to intercept? Oh, my God. He
I think he already turned it off. Yeah. He had already turned it off.
Yeah, but I mean, yeah. I think that's literally intended, I think, to come around and hit that.
I think you're right.
So I think he actually just missed the time on that. So the fourth base does go down.
Yeah. And
getting the drone on the way there, guys, is huge.
It is. It's like that is you're delaying the expansion. And the more you can delay expansions, the better, like especially with this type of build. Because as soon as you see someone's taking a quick third and has oracles, just throw down another base. They can't kill you. You will not die. So you may as well make another hatchery as soon as possible at a base. So really cool stuff so far. Solar playing well, getting that fourth base, teching up. Looks like he is going Ling Bane style again.
Yeah, I think that Solar should stick with this. You know, even though Hush did a really good job against the Ling Bane in Game 3, I think it's still, you know, easier said than done.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's the right tech to go for. So, note, Solar very conservative, not coming out of his base at all until he has to. He does get the one Void Ray, and he's not banking Phoenixes here. So this is a little bit of a deviation from some of the games we saw earlier.
Hmm.
And he actually might just let these Shades finish. Yeah, he does. He's just going to keep chasing down these Lings. He wants Zerg to stay on the right side of the map.
This is really good SimCity that we see from Hush. And
yeah,
I mean, he's kind of got everything covered, right? He has a couple Oracles that are kind of out in the map. He's poking around with his Adepts as well. A Void Ray is cleaning out the nearby Overlords to prevent drops.
This is intended to come up here and just snipe a few drones, but there's nothing there.
Hmm.
So he does back up. Very cautious play by both these guys. We now have him going to dive in over here, try to one-shot some workers. Not that much damage done.
No
real clear lead here so far, guys.
Yeah, he's got to continue to scout, though. Like, right now he just sees slow banelings and lings. Hasn't done that much scouting with the oracles, to be honest, but it looks like he's just gearing up for a timing attack, a plus one blink. He's got a good amount of sentries. He's got a prism on the way, a ton of gateways.
To be honest, I think that's fine.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it's completely fine.
It's a really good style to play against Ling Bane specifically.
Well, it's also really good because it doesn't look like Zerg has any kind of setup for a counterattack. When you go Ling Baneling, it's not hard to hold off Ling Baneling. I mean, they might kill workers, then you have spent gas on blowing their workers up, and they just have a big-ass, sophisticated Protoss army that kills you. So what this does force Zerg to do... Oh, I'm sorry. I thought he was really just going to go. Maybe he'll
still
make a fourth. And, okay. Yeah, you're right. I thought for a sec he was just going to stop and hold the fourth base. But no, I think you're right, actually. He's going to try to push out. So this forces a Zerg to face the timing head off.
And he's making a ton of Lings, a ton of Banes. I love that he has some Ravagers in here. That's really important. Without those Ravagers, like, you can just stand like behind minerals or something and never die to Ling Bane.
Okay, now he's setting some traps down here.
Oh, that way he can't be flanked. Those are beautiful, Tasteless.
Yeah, I love it.
Oh, I'm getting sickest chills right now.
Okay, he's coming up. He's tagged the queens. Now it's going to be the angling that makes the Lings have a harder time here. So he's going to go around. Here we go.
Beautiful force fields.
Locking down those units.
Oh, my God.
Absolutely
the stasis
excellent.
Wards. Just amazing stasis wards there, screwing up everything that Solar is trying to do with this defense. Some good blink micro, good force fields here once again.
He's going to keep edging in here. Another wall of force fields. Now, he doesn't have endless amounts of these,
And the Ravager Corrosive Pile can eventually take that out.
All right, the Lings are out of there, so they're coming up for the flank now, but he's got himself in a better position.
Dude, this is really good positioning. He might actually be able to break them here. Really good Baneling connections, though.
Yeah, those
Banelings
are awesome.
But when it's all said and done, these Oracles can come in here and start to activate.
Yeah, dealing a lot of damage. The Queen's coming up, and a Spore actually hitting one of them, so we'll end up losing him, but he's warping nothing but Stalkers now. This is where Hush needs to do it. He needs to break through.
He just has to micro hard enough and dodge those Corrosive Vials.
He just wants to want it. He
just
needs
to want it
bad enough.
If we cheer for him hard enough, he'll win. He's continuing to come up right now. Now, this is where Protoss Army Sophistication drops out because the other technical units have been killed off, and he has to rely just on the Blink Micro. Now, note, Zerg wasn't mining from that base. They just started again. I don't know what that War Prism is doing there, but it needs to get out.
Okay, this...
He goes back. He's retracting.
Thank God he made a fourth base, right?
Yeah.
Like, he would be super dead
However,
if he didn't have a fourth right now.
Artosis, he's going to be very susceptible to the counterattack. Zerg takes a fifth base and can just decide to attack across now.
He doesn't really have sentries in his army anymore. It's just Blink Stalkers. So he's got to do anything he can with these, like slow this down a little bit while he techs back up. Like, he's getting charge, he's getting plus two, immortals, all that jazz, but he doesn't have it yet. So,
I
like, this
Solar
army right now is scary.
He's actually sitting the
He might be able to. Yeah.
Solar's, like, going really head-on into this.
Those Ravagers really have made such a difference in this game.
They certainly did, Artosis.
Really great
They were able to break the force fields and eventually allow the Banelings to have the connections they need. If he didn't have those, he would have definitely lost that. He's coming up again. He's got to blink away the weaker units. We have one Void Ray here.
Oh, that's... Quite annoying,
thorn
actually.
Thorn in the paw of the Zerg army.
He's
got to
wait for
the queen. Yeah,
that slows him down a lot.
Yeah,
charge is on the way. Thing is, if he can get rid of all the Banelings before charge is really...
Oh, that's
so smart.
That's so smart. He blinks in so that some of the Banelings actually just connect with the Stalkers.
But the Banelings there hit a lot of those Zealots. Very good
now,
move.
Now, hold on. He's got the pylon cannon.
He's going to hold this.
Yeah.
He's going to hold it for sure.
With two Immortals, he's got to be careful with that one Mortal in the middle.
Okay, good Corrosive Vials do come down, kind of get him back a little bit.
Zerg is making nothing but Lings, Roaches, and look, 10 Banelings, actually.
He's attacking, like, a couple gates. Like, Hush doesn't care about those so much. All he needs to do is keep this fourth base alive and build up the Immortal count, which is exactly what he's doing right now.
Well, it's almost only Ravagers left over, where the Protoss can actually come in and just start to kill that. Now, the next Baneling connect is going to be pretty important here. He's actually pulling probes out of here. So that's really showing the instability of the fourth base for Protoss.
Yeah, he wants to try to keep that Nexus alive. And the more Solar attacks it, the more he has to push forward very quickly and get value on this army. But it looks like the Nexus will go down. That's a solid kill
Great
by Solar.
Great attack. Now notice he just pulls away.
Yeah. So
Gonna keep
smart.
His lead.
So
a
smart.
A lesser player would have tried to go in and take him out and end the game. But he says, no. Go back, regroup, and get more ahead. Comes out again. Now, Protoss, I think this is ill-advised, is trying to actually push out again. I don't think this is going to be a wise decision.
Okay. This is, like, right now, Solar's winning for sure, and he's in a good position for sure. I like that Hush pressures, but he needs to stay back. The way to actually try to win this game, I would say, is continuing to build high-tech units. Because
I think it has to be a war of attrition.
Yes,
he's
got to
hang on and accept the fact that he's going to have to try to last for a while here.
The Zerg army, this army that he has, over time gets worse and worse and worse. So
that's correct.
He needs to live for a long time against this right now. That's his chance.
The Zerg army, yeah, you're right. The Zerg army loses equity the longer the game goes on as Protoss can get more technical in their unit composition. Now, harassing is fine here, but the real challenge here for Hush is to weather the Zerg storm, and that storm is coming right now.
He's got over 40 more army supply right now than Hush, so this is going to be very tough indeed. Trying to buy time with these Stalkers, that is a lot of Banelings coming in. Blinks all over the place. The Banelings, it almost doesn't even matter what they hit. So much damage coming out. Oh my god, I think it might just be too much.
It might be. There's still three Immortals. Now down to two. He's trying to warp in some Zealots here. Still keeping these pylon cannons going. 34 Lings are hatching as we cast this. And I'm not sure. I think just barely, somehow, some way, Solar had enough to crack Hush. And I think from here it is going to be GG.
It does look like a tasteless kill in that fourth base. Once again, all the Immortals gone. Hush just has nothing left to speak of. Wow. This was a good game and a good series. And look at Solar, man. He just immediately stuck out his tongue. He's like, oh my god, that was so hard. That was so close.
Wow. Okay, Solar taking a big sigh of relief there. You know, Hush did a great job. But yep. the narrative continues. Hush is a good player that cannot make it into Code S.
Yeah.
Great to practice with, according to all pro gamers. But when he comes here for a live match, for when it really counts, he doesn't have what it takes.
And you know what, Tasis? I think he played a brilliant game right there. But Solar did outplay him at the end of the day.
Yeah, like, that's true.
I don't even think that was so much choking. I think he played very well. There was, like, maybe one really good Baneling Connect when he was hitting the fourth base. If you recall, it killed all the sentries. But I think Hush played that last game very well. It didn't feel to me like a choke loss.
No. So he didn't have anything weird where we thought, ooh, man. I mean, the only thing I can think of was the probe count, 46 probes. But
he won that game.
Yeah, so you can't really be too critical about that. We are going to go to a short break. When we come back, we've got a great TBT coming up, our final match in the GSL Code A. Stay tuned.
그대로 맑고 깨끗하게 피어나라고 겨울을 이겨낸 봄꽃이 내게 말했다. 맑고 깨끗한 칠성사이다.
안녕하세요. DJ학계로 세 번째 MC를 맡게 된 솔리나라고 합니다. 오늘은 스튜디오가 아니라 인장소랑 어울리는 분이 오늘 오셨는데요. 와 안녕하세요. 저는 노래하는 BJ 솔리나라고 합니다. 지금 방송한 지 얼마 안 된 따끈따끈한 신입 BJ라고 들었는데 혹시 사실인가요? 네, 저는 한 달도 안 됐고 이제 막 23일 정도 돼가는 완전 신생아 BJ입니다. 그럼 아프리카 TV 방송은 어떤 계기로 시작하게 되셨나요? 평소에 아프리카를 하고 싶기도 했고 어떤 분이 저한테 권유를 하셨죠. 하게 하면 어떻겠냐라고 하셔가지고 저도 욕심이 생겨서 하게 됐어요. 노래 컨텐츠를 하고 있는데 언제부터 가수를 꿈꼈어요? 초등학교 3학년 때부터 가수가 하고 싶었는데 실질적으로 실천에 옮긴 건 중학교 2학년 때부터였죠. 혹시 이거는 팬분들의 질문인데 가수 중에 혹시 롤모델이나 좋아하는 가수가 있으신가요? 네! 팝 가수 중에 제시제이라는 분이 있는데 그건 제 롤모델이자 정말 제일 세상에서 제일 좋아하는 가수. 요즘 빠져있는 노래 하나 추천해 주시자면 요즘에 제가 빠져있는 곡은 아델의 헬로라는 곡인데 그거 진짜 제가 엄청 좋아해요. 그 노래 혹시 팬분들을 위해서 한 곡 해주실 수 있으신가요? 네! 제가 뭐 맨날 들려드리지만 오늘 또 특별하게 여기서 불러드릴게요. 소울리나가 매일매일 새로운 곡 들고 찾아가니까요. 많이들 놀라주셨으면 좋겠습니다. 월요일은 휴방이에요. 월요일날 오면 안 돼요? 많이 찾아와요. 안녕.
여러분 안녕하세요. 짬짜면 복짜면 복짜면 복탕보 탕볶밥 먹다가 고추 잡채, 소프트 크림, 황다기, 전가루 유린기. 아, 이게 어디로 먹어야 될지 막 지금 막 누가를 뒤집힙니다. 체지방이 쌓이기 전에 그리고 콜레스테롤이 쌓이기 전에 이렇게 먹으면서 관리를 하는 거죠. 메타그린과 함께 또 맛있는 먹방 또 진행하도록 하겠습니다. 안녕, 우리 여러분 건강해져요. 밥 먹으면서 안녕.
거의 게임 마스터. 무슨 게임을 하더라도 뭐 기본 이상.
네. 지금 그걸 연습할 때가 아닙니다. 그렇습니다. 이렇게 하는 거예요.
이겼나?
이겼나 이거?
추가 시간. 좋아 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 좋아.
자리야 킬.
나이스.
드디어 드디어.
소나님이랑 닮았다는 소리를 듣는데 LW 팀 소개합니다. 저를 키우는 게 보통이 아니거든요. 파이팅! 나이스! 공 한번 쓰죠.
한번 죽였어요.
나이스!
와! 이겼어. 야! 어디?
게임 방송에서도 할 의향이 있어요.
방패 정도는.
아, 우리 범 선수에 다시 한번 박수 치면서.
진짜 박수를 한번.
이거 순장 미팅이냐?
이게 뭐라 그러지? 굉장히 되죠? 느낌 왔어! 자, 들어가자. 지금이에요! 마무리야!
오버워치
파이팅! Welcome to a GSM.
It's time for the last match and the last day of this GSL Code A. After this, we are going on to the GSL Code S. We will have our pantheon of esports StarCraft II nerd god ballers.
That's right. The only League of Legends you need to watch is GSL Code S.
And it's going to be between Reality and Mario. And I think a lot of people assume that Mario is going to... Mario.
Mario.
Mario. that there's a new Mario coming out. A lot of you guys are going to assume that Mario is going to zip right out of this, and it's a possibility, but I got to tell you guys, Reality is a very strong TBT player.
Yeah.
He's one of the best TBTers in the world. This is going to be no easy match for Mario.
I do expect Mario to win, as you say, but like, you can't underestimate this guy. He's really, really, really good at TBT, guys.
This guy on his team has picked out a lot of times to just take out other Terrans.
Yeah. He had the sickest game against Ryung recently in Pro League, like over an hour and whatnot. It was just a crazily well-played TBT match. His defense is really solid. His movements are really precise. This guy has a big range of play as well. He's definitely one of these players that could possibly bust out mech tonight. We could be so lucky to see such a great thing. But Mario is like, well, he's Mario, right? He's... You could argue he's the best player in the world right now.
Some people would.
Yeah.
Some people do.
Like, he's right up there with TY. He's Mario, guys. He's Mario. And, like, he's looking to get deep. Well, look, here's a funny thing as well, by the way. He plays SSL tomorrow. So he's got 10 hours of StarCraft tomorrow, and he's got to qualify tonight. And he needs to get into at least one of these leagues to have a chance at BlizzCon.
This might be his chance right now. We are going to be hopping into this game momentarily. I think Mario takes this, but yeah, I mean, Reality is very good.
Yeah.
And I would not be surprised if Reality is really not that nervous about this match.
I don't think he should be nervous.
Yeah, I think so.
The pressure's on Mario here. Like, Reality isn't sitting there being like, okay, I got to win this season and go to BlizzCon. Reality is sitting there like, I want to get into Code S first, and then I'll think about other things. Mario, you know, like...
Mario's at that level where he's had so much success, you're kind of... You got way more ambitious goals as a pro gamer, you know?
He's way too beast to not be at BlizzCon, and, like, there's way too much money on the line. You know, he's killing Pro League too hard. Like, you know, he needs to win this match.
I think he's currently number two in wins in Pro League as well.
Yeah,
it's
Hero
crazy.
Has, like, two more wins or something.
I think Hero's just played more games, though.
Yeah. He has way more losses.
Always ace match.
Mario's, like, 12-1 against, like, Hero's, like, maybe... 13-5 or something, or 14-5-4
or something. I'm not sure. All right, guys. Map number one is going to be on Dusk Towers. Definitely tell your friends to tune in. We'll have about, what, 1 week, 2 weeks off? And then we'll be going right into the GSL Code S. This is our final match in Code A. A Terran versus Terran, Reality versus Mario. Let's go. In the upper right in the blue, one of our two Terran players, he is.
Samsung Galaxy Reality.
In the bottom left, the favorite in this matchup, he is.
Gineo Green Wings, Maru.
Right. Everyone's really excited for Mario to possibly get in and maybe even win GSL Code S. He's definitely one of the favorites to win this season, even though he hasn't won this match yet. Kid is so strong right now at Legacy of the Void. Hello, nerds.
So do I act normal? Do I laugh? Like, what do I do?
Like, laugh a few times.
Laugh just a couple times. I might just want to cover all the ranges of emotions, you know, before I get this off camera, so I get at least one of them right.
Let's go through, like, the seven stages of acceptance or something, like, right there on the camera.
I saw this, I was, last night, I was up a little bit later than normal. I was watching Louis C.K. stand-up, and he was talking about, you ever seen, like, a guy on a first date, like, walking down the street with a girl, and, like, he's constantly... He's like never himself. He's like attempting to be a different guy every 5 seconds, like a funny guy, and then a loud guy, and then a wise guy, and then a
yeah.
That's what that made me think of back there. So TVT on this map, this could be a really long game.
Oh yeah.
This is you know, TVT is the matchup that, you know, you typically identify as having that no man's land theme, like trench warfare going on.
Yeah.
And, you know, on a map like this, it certainly can lend itself to, you know, games going on incredibly long, maps being cut in half, us having to rely purely on drops because an on-ground engagement is insane.
Yeah, yeah. That's definitely something, especially on Dusk Towers, that happens quite often.
Yeah.
I do wonder if we're going to see mech possibly here. If we did, it would be out of Reality, not Mario. Like, Mario, like, Mario only really falls back does on mech if it's mech. Broken.
Yeah,
like, it has to be completely
he'll
broken.
He'll only go for mech
it.
If it's like, well, this has been solved.
Yeah.
But Mario actually really likes infantry play.
Yeah, he is the king of Marauders. Like, he is just better with them than anyone. Like, he's so quick overall just with bio.
Yeah.
It just really lends itself, to his style and to his strengths. But reality, we have seen mech out of him before. He's definitely, like, a very flexible player in that regard. I'm not expecting it, but it might be a smart way to play against Maru, because aren't you going to get out-marine tanked? You know?
Theoretically, yeah. Nice control here, a little dogfight with the two Reapers.
Well, very fast third command center has come up for Maru. But overall, it's like pretty similar, the styles that they're bringing out now.
Okay, so reality is going to go for, I think, what is kind of traditional TV T, getting the Banshee.
Mm-hmm.
This is sort of how we saw TVT start out in StarCraft II, and it's really never gone away. If the Banshee wasn't in the game, this whole matchup would operate differently.
Yeah.
Every build would be different. It would be a completely new game because whether or not you get the Banshee, the threat of the Banshee is so great that the Terran player has to play around that entire fact.
Yeah. Early on when people were bad against Banshees, do you remember?
Bit by Bit Prime.
That was bad with Banshees. I'm talking about bad at defending. Like, I remember there was a time where, like, if you made a cloaked Banshee, you could rack up minimum 10 SCV kills every time.
Oh, it was crazy. You'd have both guys going for Banshees, and
they
then
just
eventually
all lose everything. It was, like, really.
Well, I mean, it's a tough unit to deal with. I mean, yeah. And now we see people, like, really get ready to defend against it in every way imaginable. So, from Maru, it seems like we're going to have the more conservative route, which is to get a Raven.
Mm-hmm.
And this is not just to try to stop Banshees, but it can stop other things like drops.
Yeah.
And other forms of harass because of auto turret, because you have free detection. Now, of course, the Raven's not a nimble unit. It doesn't get there very quickly. So what you end up having to do is get the Raven in the right position and try to cut off that unit before it can get away.
Decent damage so far.
Here we go.
Definitely have to say. Okay, going to want to run out of there.
Now, if he can get see how he's arcing it a little bit?
Yeah.
He wants to make it so that the Banshee actually will get boxed in no matter what. Oh, I'm surprised he didn't chase that all the way.
Yeah.
There is a lot of times
he might be afraid
of
another
second Banshee.
Yeah.
Yeah. And there it is now.
Mm-hmm. Looks like, actually, this is funny. This is the opposite of what I predicted would happen here. Maru is going to be the one going for mech.
Yeah, look at that.
Which is obviously really cool because it means he's just so smart and handsome. Reality is going for bio play. So this is, like, yeah, this is not what I expected here, but this lends me to think that there's a possibility that mech on this map really is the answer, just because of kind of the map layout and whatnot. Because, again, like, Maru is normally the last guy that would go mech, just generally speaking. He picked up mech in TVZ when it was so broken that, like, Beal in his prime could not stop it, you know?
I remember that, yeah.
And
that,
like,
was kind of an ugly time.
That was an ugly time.
In StarCraft 2, where I'm like, all right, this
and
is what the
Heart
game
of the
looks
Swarm
like.
Had some gross things
there
going on.
There were definitely some moments where I'm like, okay, so this is what we have become. The future we have wrought.
Yeah. Well, I'm, like, really pretty, like, my voice might not bring it up because my throat is kind of sore, but, like, I'm really excited to see this mech play from Maru. And, like, how is reality going to actually break Maru? Because, like, Maru is generally known as just kind of being faster, better at harassment, multitasking, it's completely solid in macro. So, like, how does reality beat him with, like, this very common strategy, just, like, bio tank?
Yeah, it's a good question. Maru is definitely intending for this game to be about a half hour long, Artosis.
Oh, yeah.
Unless he sees some weakness here. Normally, when you're doing something like this, especially as you can see, it's very tank-dependent mech. There was a period where people did a lot of weird stuff, like Hellion and Thor in certain matchups. I mean, and there's always been, whether it's StarCraft 1 or StarCraft 2, there's been a variety of different mech builds you can do.
Yeah.
But whenever you see a guy just getting a lot of tanks, that usually means they just don't want to attack. They want to not be touched. Mm. And the Vikings, of course, are also another indicator because they keep the tanks protected from drops.
Yeah. And you know what? When you're very right. Like the
are
tank
you
count,
serious? Okay, it gets away. Never mind.
The tank count does have so much to do with like when you're planning to attack. Only
right.
Supernova would make tanks an attack. And, yeah, he's in the army now, so.
Back when he would have 150 supply, and I'm like, I don't know, he's on CG now.
Yeah.
This is a thing. And other people started doing it.
Huh.
And even when other people were doing it, I'm like, I'm not sure if when Supernova was doing it, it was right, but we're just in this trend right now.
nice little attack out here by Maro, pushing everything back. Look at this. He's actually got map control, thanks to the Vikings and Hellions, very now, mobile units.
You might be wondering, why does he have Hellions? This is what we call a mineral dump, because basically what you actually want is just stuff that costs gas, but as you can clearly see, and if you followed any StarCraft 2, you'd notice people get minerals more because of their abundance than gas. So you kind of like got to use those minerals somewhere. So what they do is they make a bunch of Hellions and just kind of try to make them work.
Yeah.
And they're very expendable. They're about as expendable as Zerglings. Ouch.
Definitely. He can lose quite a few. He needs something to tank a little bit for his units until he gets the really gigantic numbers of tanks and whatnot. And then you don't need any tanking because the tanks do all the tanking.
Yeah, no pun intended.
By tanking there, I don't mean like tanking the damage, but rather dealing the damage so quick nothing can touch them.
That's right.
But definitely need these Hellions in this early part of the game. And, you know, as long as there's blows on both sides, you'll see them throughout the game. But, you know, the ultimate tech that Maro's going for doesn't really include Hellions that much.
Okay.
Reality is like flying around, but where is he going to be able to find damage?
Well, this is the annoying part of being a player who's going for bio. You see he's got infantry and some tanks. He wants to do a fair Terran versus Terran fight. Maro is doing what we call turtling. And I know that turtling, people say that there, you know, there's turtling a lot in StarCraft too. There's nothing like mech turtling.
Yeah. Well, mech turtling is
maybe when Zerg only gets
so
spores
strong.
And broodlords. But I mean, there's that too. But basically, you turtle up, and this is obviously for the scrubs and the plebs that are watching. We got you covered. It does refer to actual turtle.
And the plebs.
Yeah, man. We got. You just have to imagine an actual turtle, right? What happens if you get close to the turtle? It goes in its shell.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's what we're seeing here. So right now, what Reality's trying to do, not particularly successfully. Well, actually, it's kind of working. Is he's trying to find a hole in the defense or an area where he can scrape off some damage. And I actually got to say, he cut off 5 mineral patches and a gas. That's what he needed to do.
Yeah, and he's doing okay with it, but mech can kind of take its time retaking that.
Yeah, and that's the thing that makes mech so difficult. Now, you got to be a player who's got a lot of stamina and a lot of focus to play mech.
Mm-hmm.
Because even if you're trading tanks, you're eventually just going to have more tanks. The game's going to go on for longer. Now, this drop over here, I got to say, I think the turtle has been pulled out of its shell. He's actually come in here, and this may be why we don't see mech as much in StarCraft II, unlike Brood War, is that it's not as bamboo solid.
Yeah,
it's
a little bit tough right now.
Yeah.
He doesn't quite have that turret ring tight enough to keep everything out, so definitely taking a lot of damage. Reality doing a very good job of peeling him apart before he's completely sewn up. Like, this was kind of his only opportunity to get something like this done, too, because if you sit for another 2 minutes, Maro has too much, and you're not going to be able to do that damage.
Now, you may be asking yourself, well, isn't Maro cleaning off all these units, though? I mean, isn't he still just fine? Look at the supply, though. 150, now 160 to 118. Now, the tank count is getting lower and lower as these attacks come in and do damage, because he is actually taking them out. There can be a point where this will snowball here and Reality can take the game. If not, Reality, as we can already see here, is still taking up, he's gobbling up all the bases on the right side of the map. And that's already, like, another problem.
Reality's playing really, really well here. And something he did before all those attacks that we just saw, which already were great, is he added 2 more starports, which is so important. When you're going bio tank against mech, you have to skip your way up to Sky Terran eventually.
That's
right.
And he
had that ready before he lost his units, and his Remax is coming in with a lot of Liberators and a lot of Vikings. And this is giving him the perfect opportunity to win this game, because now he's done damage.
He has map control,
he has more bases, and he has Sky Terran on the way.
Yeah, think about it like DBZ. This is not even my final form.
Yeah.
You know?
You got to switch out if you don't kill him. And he was never thinking he was going to kill Maro by now, but hell, he got a lot of damage. Reality's playing fantastically here.
Yeah, this is about as good from bio play against mech as you can really ever see.
Yeah.
And he's even shifting, as you were saying, Artosis, into that next phase.
Yeah, his Viking count is off the hook. Like, he's going to absolutely win the air battle. And as soon as you win the air battle against Mech, Mech's in a lot of trouble.
Now, if this game goes on for an hour, and that's actually not out of the question.
It is totally possible.
It's completely possible. The odd predicament that reality gets into is that the right side of the map has all the resources gobbled up before the left side is.
Yeah.
And then the slow spreading blob-like Terran that is meching can then consume the upper left side of the map. And just so you know, if you had to get territory, you'd cut this map exactly down the middle. All the right side of the bases are more accessible for the blue player. All the left side bases are accessible to the red players. So,
and the bases at like 12 and 6, those are gold, and they're really hard to keep.
Yeah, and we'll see if those actually become a factor. Yeah. I think they very well may.
They could. Yeah.
But this is what Mech looks like, you know, when you see Mario playing here, is kind of like this giant, these giant limbs slowly stretching out and taking a grabbing an expansion and then bolstering up.
Exactly.
And then like becoming like iron, like titanium alloy or whatever the strongest thing is.
It's unobtainium.
Unobtainium. That's
right. Well, it matters what movie, I guess. Like, what's that terrible superhero Captain America?
The guy that fights with a shield.
Yeah.
Worst weapon ever.
The best offense is a good defense, Stasis. I don't know if you've ever heard that before, but it's definitely true. Now, whatever his shield is made out of is like a really strong metal.
Yeah. Or maybe whatever Thor's hammer is made out of as well. But yeah, so you see this mech army come out and then like grab a part of a map and then it just like hangs onto it and it kind of absorbs all the blows and then another limb comes out and those arms are going to continue to reach out to the northwest side of the map in this game.
Now,
and again, we don't actually get to cast
this
style
so
a lot,
great.
But this is actually something that was it's actually been common in some iterations of StarCraft II. I know we have new people that watch that weren't as into StarCraft until Legacy, but this is something. It was especially a big theme in Brood War, and it kind of there's like echoes of it in StarCraft II. But we're gonna see in this now. So this is an interesting way that Terrans can play, and it was initially biggest in TVP, and then it's a lot in TVT. Although TVT is like such a weird matchup, that's a talk for another time. But but this is what we're seeing unfold here now. Why are we seeing SCVs come in here, you might be asking? Well, because they're both maxed out, and now workers aren't as important. And this is where, and this is basically only common in TBT, historically in all StarCraft, is that you start to shave off SCVs in lieu of getting a better army.
Now, one thing I've got to point out, Tasis, the air army is way better for reality, but we do have a quick burrow upgrade here for these Widow Mines, Drilling Claws.
Now,
and that's going to help out a lot because one or two Widow Mines hits, and that Sky Army is going down. Okay, looks like he does burn.
Now he's pulling them away. That obliterates the Ground Army, zips him back.
Ooh.
Now, Terran can push out with the Mech Army when they've maxed out and they've got enough factories to keep producing. So that's what we're seeing. But you got to be very cautious with the Mech Army. If you overextend, you lose all your tanks, and then it's like you're back to square one. So as scary as the army that Mario has, he has to keep it doing the optimum amount of damage and ideally not losing. Well, he can lose the Widow Mines, that's okay, but he cannot lose the
Those are super cheap. In fact, just spreading those out is really, really smart right now.
Yeah, this is actually
pretty
smart.
Making use up a bunch of scans. The thing is, you don't care about mules as much right now.
Now,
the scans are definitely more
the
useful.
The Liberators, and this is kind of the weird phase of Mech and Legacy, is that the Liberators actually allow reality to not have to make a ground army. As funny as that sounds.
Yeah, you have to be careful, though, because...
But he kind of has to play whack-a-mole against these tanks that are pretty mobile. So no siege mode. Well, that can work, too.
Yeah, just...
Turns out those things can land. I almost forgot about that.
But look at the way that Mario's playing this. He's just consistently making Widow Mines, so he's actually utilizing all his factories, which is really efficient.
Yeah, that's right.
Widow Mines are cheap, and making a bunch of Vikings as well. So he's focusing on Vikings rather than Liberators. So if you have too many Liberators, and your opponent goes only Vikings and has room to kite, Vikings will beat Liberators in that sense.
I think he's going to go for a bunch of Ravens and try to Seeker Missile the
could be
the Vikings.
Yeah, it looks like Banshee Speed on the way as well. That's what the new Reaper thing up. Thing is, right? Yeah, that. I believe that's the upgrade is Banshee Speed.
Well, that can work.
Yeah, I mean, well, he's going on flying units. He's got a bank. May as well get it. I guess.
Problem though for reality, when I look at this, is that I don't know if you can actually break a Mech Terran. Like he can drive away these bases, but eventually Mario's going to have the upper left, and then there is going to be that
advantage in the early game with bases that becomes a disadvantage later on.
There's definitely something what you say. If you look at the economy, Rally's been mining twice as much as Maru for a while.
Yeah.
And doesn't really have that much of a bigger bank. He's being, like, in some ways a little bit less cost efficient, I guess. But, you know, Maru, like, if you can dodge all these mine hits, then eventually he's just kind of, you know, giving you units. Mines don't have the greatest range. He's looking for Reality to make a mistake around these mines. This is so cool, though, from Maru. Oh, my God.
Yeah. Well, you know, the funny thing is because he mech'd up, he does have the bank to switch techs. So now we're in another phase of the game where they're going to start rotating through techs. After a big fight's won, you're going to try to switch and counter like your opponent's army with a tech that counters what they won the fight with.
Yeah, for instance, if you go too many Vikings, suddenly the bio player can go back into Marine Marauder and just kill you because Vikings can't kill that.
Yeah.
Right? So it's like you have to be actually very careful balancing these units. But with this many Widow Mines and a few Siege Tanks still up, this is – I tell you, this is really cool.
Okay.
This now, is so
the,
cool.
The predicament for Maru is Maru has to crack the bottom right. And it looks like Rally wants to use the Banshees to come up there and harass the other base. Now, note the other the excess of orbitals. Actually, I shouldn't even call it excess. That's the right amount of orbitals you want to have.
Yeah.
You just land mules.
This is a crazy game right now.
Yeah. Well, we're about to hit the 20-minute marker, and I think we have plenty more time in this game as well.
Yeah, someone would have to screw up, and their banks are starting to get pretty big, too, and they both have a lot of production. So
now it looks like we're nearing the end of Maru actually cleaning up this bottom right side of the map.
Mm.
And if he does do that, this advantage goes to Maru.
Okay, kills off that command center. And Reality, you know, his mining definitely being impeded quite
greatly. Okay, here we go. I almost think he should have ran underneath that with the Widow Mines. I'm not sure.
It can be risky, but if he gets the Widow Mine hits, that's going to be a victory.
All right, we got a lot of point defense drones coming down here. Oh, misplayed.
Okay, look at that. For instance, that, he forced everything back, but he lost a lot of Widow Mines and did no damage with them. So this is the type of situation that Reality needs to win with, is abusing him for making this many Widow Mines.
I think Maru's trying to run the clock out in this bottom right side of the map. I think that this is actually an army he can lose. He doesn't want to, ideally, but as long as Reality's not mining from here and Reality's not hitting the upper left,
if he loses that army, though, can he hold on to his other bases?
Maybe. I think he can remake it, actually. This is not a lot of units that we see in the bottom right. I think he's, like, almost going to remax it. Look, he's at 184 supply. There's, like, two tanks and some Widow Mines. His tanks are just, like, on a suicide mission. Not every day I get to cast a tank not in siege mode shooting a Marine, so that was exciting.
A lot of Ravens being added in.
Yeah.
I got to say, I actually like the way Reality has played this game more. Aside from his not choosing mech, that was definitely a mistake. But other than that, I really like everything about the way he's playing. Like, this is really fresh and new for Maru to have all these Widow Mines, but they haven't done that much. Reality's playing very defensively against them, not letting them get hits. He's not, you know, he's like, okay, I'll lose those two bases. As long as I'm not losing this air army, I can always float another orbital down there.
By the way, I think this is only going to, the only game that we're going to have that looks like this will be this game on this map.
Yeah.
This map, this is actually a very important map in StarCraft 2. I hope you guys know, because this map actually does reward different play styles. And the more we get maps that have drastic changes on them that allow for different play styles, the more interesting games we have. And I know it's the opposite of what every pro gamer wants. They want the most basic bro map that they can have. They want to put a backwards baseball cap on every map and make it as basic as possible. But when you start to put crazy stuff like this on the map, that's when you get crazy games.
And this is definitely a crazy one that we're watching. This will not necessarily end too soon, but I gotta say, the more I keep looking at this, the later game composition is not coming from the mech player. The fact that Reality went so early into a complete Sky Terran switch and has now made this many Ravens, he can point defense drone for decades.
Yeah. So, we have Reality just out on the edge here, continuing to scan and push in.
Oh.
And good job, good runaway.
Mm-hmm. Got to do that, but that's just energy. It's not that big a deal.
Now, the thing is, I think Reality's army actually is scarier, but the problem is Reality's army can't kill buildings.
Dude, what do you think about these ghosts with Cloak that he's making? I'm trying to figure this out.
Oh, my God. Hold up, Artosis.
Oh, he's serious.
This is the only time I've ever seen anything that looks like this.
We are literally watching Widowmines run across a map and chase an army.
Now he's trying to get to be cornered over here. I've never seen anything like this.
But look, these auto turrets are wrecking them. These Widowmines being worth nothing right now.
This is actually a lot of ingenuity here from both players.
Wow.
That is, I've never seen that in my entire
life. No, I've never seen anything like this. Holy crap, what a good night of Code A.
Yeah, well, the funny thing is because it's like Vikings and Ravens, then I guess there really isn't an immediate answer to shoot down the Widowmines, you know?
Yeah.
Normally, Widowmines have to come in and hold the position. Now, he's actually shut out the center control of the map, which means once again, Morrow gets to beat down the bottom right.
Dude,
that is so crazy.
Yeah. Now, I gotta talk to you about these ghosts. What are these? What is?
Dude, I don't know.
The ghosts are so interesting here.
I'm actually not sure.
I mean, I don't know. Maybe
it's preventing the other player from getting Ravens
because
of EMP.
Yeah, that could be it.
But other than that, I'm not sure. And now, did he make nuke silos or anything?
No, he hasn't.
He has not, right?
He hasn't.
Yeah.